In the middle of the Saudi Arabian desert, the NEOM Green Hydrogen Project is about to officially become the world's largest green hydrogen plant. There's just one problem. It won't be producing any hydrogen at all. At a cost of $8.4 billion, it's powered by 4 gigawatts of dedicated wind and solar power, and it's already 80% complete as of this filming. But again, not a single molecule of pure hydrogen is scheduled for export. So what is the world's biggest hydrogen plant actually making? And why is this the blueprint for a new $500 billion global industry? Let's figure this out together. I'm Ricky, and this is Tuba Da Vinci. This video is brought to you by Jackery. So I wasn't being dramatic. Saudi Arabia is building the world's largest green hydrogen plant in Oxagon, a futuristic 8.5 square mile industrial port city roughly the size of Boston. The industrial complex is part of their massive multi-trillion-dollar NEOM mega project, and it's already 80% complete. It should be fully completed by the next year and begin commercial operations in 2027. It will produce 600 tons of pure hydrogen every day. However, it isn't built to export that hydrogen. Instead, its final product, the molecule that'll get loaded onto massive tanker ships in the Oxagon port, is green ammonia. 3,400 tons of it every day, equivalent to about 7.75 terawatt hours annually. And it's not just NEOM, it's the new standard in the growing green hydrogen industry. An overwhelming 85% of all announced hydrogen trade projects plan to use ammonia as their hydrogen carrier for exporting renewable energy. The logic is that you can produce hydrogen, turn it into ammonia, ship it, then turn it back into hydrogen when you want to use it. So the natural question is, why go through all the trouble to produce hydrogen and then turn it into something else only to turn it back into hydrogen later? And to answer that, we have to ask ourselves, why hydrogen at all? Now, we've gone back and forth on the pros and cons of hydrogen on this channel, but as of the making of this video, there are some reasons why it could make sense. The problem today isn't making cheap, clean energy anymore. Today, wind and solar are already way cheaper than the cheapest fossil fuels by 40 to 50%. The problem is where you can harvest that energy. The best places on Earth for renewable energy, the sun-scorched deserts of Saudi Arabia, Morocco, and the Atacama Desert, and the wind-blasted coasts of Australia, well, they're all thousands of miles away from the industrial centers that need that power. So the real problem is moving energy from where we can make it cheaply to where we need it. But you can't just build the world's largest extension cord and hook up China to a solar park in Australia. We've actually explored a similar idea to a video we'll link here below. And we had high hopes for X-Links, the Morocco-UK power cable project that was supposed to be a proof of concept for commercial long-range solar transmission, but the project fell through last July. But what about mobility? Well, we know EVs are the clear choice for passenger cars, but there's still large shipping and aircraft and other things that we need to electrify. And when it comes to large amounts of energy in a small amount of space, that's historically where fuels have shined. And hydrogen is no exception. It has the highest energy content by weight of any chemical fuel by a long shot. In principle, 1 pound of hydrogen can store the same amount of energy as 2.5 pounds of methane, and an equivalent lithium-ion battery would weigh 284 pounds. Also, contrary to fossil fuels, which release carbon when burned, hydrogen burns 100% cleanly, producing nothing but harmless water as the byproduct. And that's why there's a $500 billion industry betting on it. But before I get into that, it's fall prime big deal days, which means the absolute best prices on products we love, like the Jackery Explorer 2000 V2 solar generator. I love this little 2 kilowatt hour battery because it has 2200 watts of output, enough to power nearly everything. We take it everywhere from camping to beach days to power everything from cooktops to air pumps on our family adventures. But the Explorer 2000 isn't just great for adventures. It can be a critical part of your family's emergency preparedness plan. It can power things like your refrigerator, internet modem, or CPAP machines for days if the power ever goes out. Keep it charged, and it can respond in less than 20 milliseconds if the power goes out in UPS mode. Plug in a Solar Saga 200 watt solar panel, and you can keep the battery recharged during prolonged outages, all without gasoline or generators. The build quality is excellent, and it's surprisingly small and lightweight for how powerful it is. This prime big deal days, get the lowest price of 2025, up to 65% off, and be prepared for power outages today with the Jackery Explorer 2000 V2. Links in the description. Huge thanks to Jackery and you. Now back to the show. So why is an entire industry apparently shifting from green hydrogen to green ammonia? Well, there are a few reasons why it makes sense. Number one, hydrogen is a logistical nightmare. It's the lightest element in the universe. To ship it, you have to liquefy it, which means cooling it to negative 253 degrees Celsius, just a few degrees above absolute zero. Ammonia, on the other hand, liquefies at a relatively balmy negative 33 degrees Celsius. Standard off-the-shelf industrial refrigeration equipment can easily handle that temperature. For hydrogen, we need to develop specialized cryogenic transport ships. These are extremely expensive to build and operate, and currently hydrogen transport ships are tiny. The Japanese Suiso Frontier, the most modern liquid hydrogen tanker in the world, can carry about 1,250 cubic meters of liquid hydrogen, which is just 87.5 tons. While a typical liquefied natural gas freight ship carries 72 to 85,000 tons, over 1,000 times more. But it's not just the shipping itself. There's also boil-off. The large spherical container tanks that you see in the Suiso Frontier is the state-of-the-art at avoiding boil-off, but it still loses 0.1 to 0.5% of the hydrogen it stores per day. So during a short trip from sunny Australia to Japan, which might take 10 to 14 days, this cutting-edge hydrogen freighter would lose 1 to 7% of the hydrogen it was storing in transit alone. These specialized cryogenic ships, the constant energy drain to keep it cold, and the fact that it's always trying to boil off and escape make shipping pure hydrogen one of the most difficult and expensive engineering challenges in the world. And once you get it to where it's going, the nightmares only continue. Ammonia solves virtually all of these issues. It doesn't need cryogenic storage, it doesn't boil off like hydrogen does, and on top of that, we have a century of experience shipping ammonia around. There's already a mature global market with established infrastructure for making, storing, and shipping millions of tons of ammonia every year for things like fertilizer. There are even standardized processes and security measures in place to deal with the fact that ammonia is toxic. We don't have to invent a whole new global supply chain from scratch. The second problem with hydrogen is volumetric energy density. Now, we did talk about how hydrogen blows batteries and fuels out of the water in terms of gravimetric energy density, or how much energy it stores per unit mass. But hydrogen's volumetric energy density, while much better than a battery, is only one-third of that of the best fossil fuels. That means that to get the same amount of energy of, let's say, 100 gallons of jet fuel, you'd need three times the volume, or roughly 300 gallons of liquefied hydrogen. So while the hydrogen would be a lot lighter, the tank would take up a lot more space, and on an aircraft that you're trying to put passengers and cargo into, that could be a problem. At 8 to 9 millijoules per liter, hydrogen's volumetric energy density is also roughly 40% lower than that of ammonia's, which stands at 12.9 to 14.4 megajoules per liter. So that's a pretty good case for ammonia over hydrogen. So while stories and reports about hydrogen are pretty common, you might not know as much about ammonia. So let's just quickly put on our lab coats and do a little bit of an exploration into why ammonia is so much better than hydrogen. And I promise, I'll keep it simple. Let's start by looking at what green ammonia actually is and how the NEOM Green Hydrogen plant will make it. Ammonia, NH3, is a simple molecule made of one nitrogen atom and three hydrogen atoms. If you use green hydrogen to produce ammonia, you call that product green ammonia. So far, so good. So you take green hydrogen that you just created from clean sources and combine it with nitrogen, which conveniently for us is 80% of the air that we breathe. And voila, you get green ammonia using a century-old industrial process called Haber-Bosch. But this is a really energy-intensive process, which is the entire challenge that it faces. But we'll get back to that here in a minute. But let's see if the economics actually work out. Let's start with the path they didn't choose, liquid hydrogen. It's a five-stage process. You start with 100% of your renewable electricity. After electrolysis, the best case, you're down to about 80%. After the massive energy cost of liquefaction, you're down to 60%. After storage and transport, where some of it boils off, you might be around 59%. Then you run through a fuel cell to get electricity back, and you're left at just 36% of the energy that you started with. And that's best case. In a more typical or worst case scenario, that number could drop all the way down to a painful 11%. Now let's look at the ammonia pathway. You still have the initial hit from electrolysis, but then you have two new painful steps. First, you take your pure hydrogen and combine it with nitrogen from the air using the century-old energy-hogging Haber-Bosch process to synthesize ammonia. Best case, last step is about 72% efficient. Then after shipping, if you want pure hydrogen back, you have to use even more energy to crack the ammonia molecule apart, which can be, let's say, 96% efficient. When you cascade all these new losses, the best case round trip efficiency for the ammonia pathway is around 39%. It's slightly better than liquid hydrogen, but still, you're throwing away over 60% of your initial energy, all in the name of easier logistics. This is the brutal choice engineers are facing. There is no easy path. Every option is a compromise that wastes an almost criminal amount of energy. So this brings us back to the biggest question: knowing all of this, why are we still doing it? Why is there so much money going into this industry? And the answer is because they're making a calculated $500 billion bet that this massive inefficiency ultimately doesn't matter. Not if the scale is big enough, and most importantly, the input energy is cheap enough. This is where the global players come in. Japan has committed $100 billion because it has no choice. It's a manufacturing powerhouse with few domestic energy resources, and it needs to import stable, clean molecules to survive. The US is in for nearly $50 billion in public-private funds, not through central planning, but through the brute force economics of the Inflation Reduction Act's massive $3 per kilogram tax credit. In the Middle East, Saudi Arabia's $8.4 billion for NEOM and Oman's $49 billion plan are a direct play to pivot from being the world's oil pump to becoming the world's green energy pump. So now we've kind of laid out the producers, the customers, and the financiers, and this vision is epic, both in its ambitions and scale. But before we can get too carried away, we need a serious dose of reality because the numbers on the ground show this is still a massive uphill battle. After years of hype, the market is correcting. A recent Bloomberg analysis showed that the global investment into clean hydrogen actually halved in 2024. The International Energy Agency reports that the global project pipeline has been revised downwards as ambitious projects get delayed or canceled outright. Right now, a staggering 93% of all announced hydrogen projects for 2030 have not secured the money to actually get built. That's called the final investment decision, or FID gap, and it is a chasm. And to put this into perspective, the entire global investment in hydrogen is a tiny fraction of the broader clean energy transition. The $3.5 billion spent on hydrogen projects under construction in 2023 is less than what the world invests in solar in 3 days. The IEA says that we need to be spending $50 billion a year just on hydrogen supply to stay on track for a net zero goal. And we are nowhere close. So what does all of this mean? The massive, inefficient, and incredibly expensive bet on green hydrogen isn't a failure in the making. It's a high-risk, long-term gamble on building a global trade network for renewable energy. It's for the industries that are the hardest to decarbonize: the steel mills, the chemical plants, and the cargo ships and planes that will need real molecules and not maybe just electrons. The architects of this plan in Saudi Arabia, Japan, and the US know it's not profitable today. They're trying to force it to be. But by using gigascale projects to drive down costs and massive subsidies to create demand, they're trying to will an entire global market into existence. And when this level of money and scrutiny is invested in something, there's going to be breakthroughs. Like the hyper-efficient electrolyzers being developed by companies like Hyseda, a game changer that could change the efficiency of the electrolysis process. And that's just one part of this chain. Imagine how many breakthroughs and innovations that will come. And that's where this gamble ultimately resides. Their goal and their hope is that they can increase this to such a scale and have such cheap electricity from solar and wind, for example, that even though it might have less round-trip efficiency, it could still win out on price when compared to other forms of energy. But what do you think? Sound off in the comments below. This is a fascinating topic, and we will cover this more in future episodes. But until then, check out this video next. I'm Ricky with Tuba Da Vinci. Thank you so much for watching.